Honorable Minister for Commerce and Industry, Sri Rajiv Kher, Commerce Secretary, Mr. Rajesh Shriram, Mr. Adil Zainulbhai, Mr. Malvinder Mohan Singh, senior government officials, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of all the organizers, may I warmly welcome all of you to this very special and the second edition of the Services Conclave. As you see, led by the Department of Commerce, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, partnered by CII, there are other key partners here involved in really putting together this very important conference, the FEO, the Center for WTO Studies, and the Services Export Promotion Council. It's a privilege to welcome very warmly and specially the Honorable Finance Minister of the country, Sri Arun Jaitley, to this very important conference. So you're really in charge of the economy, and therefore it's very important for all of us to give you our feedback on this very important sector, and also to listen to your views and your vision, which we would, from the services sector industry side, would really be like to take that forward. Therefore, it will be very important to have you at the start of this session, and we are once again very, very proud to welcome you very warmly. May I also very specially welcome Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman, the Minister for Commerce and Industry. Madam, for the last 5.5 months, it's been a great partnership with your ministry for the industry, and we have looked up to you for your leadership, and it's been your very sincere efforts which has seen some of the most important steps which have been taken to really help the Indian industry come out of a very strong setback, if one can say, over the last many months that one was facing. And you have been very, very closely involved with industry, participating with industry, listening to our views on various issues, and helping us really take those steps which were very, very critical to see those irritants are really removed. So your participation here, madam, is indeed very, very encouraging for all of us. Mr. Kher has been really the architect in terms of helping create this program in coordination with his colleagues. And with him, we have been involved in really taking the products and services of India across the world. The theme, ladies and gentlemen, as you see today, is promoting services export from India and the opportunities. And we all know that the opportunities are immense. And therefore, the second Services Exports Conclave really comes at a very opportune and a right time. With the world economy, including India, showing signs of recovery, it is becoming imperative for India to tap domestic and international demand for a faster economic development. Today, we think India is fortunate to have a very strong services sector and can take advantage of the global market opportunities in this space. We all know that services sector contributes about 58%, and the share of employment is also very, very strong. And we do feel that this can really be increased if we get the right policy framework, and of course, more importantly, something that we are engaged from the industry side, which is on training and skills. And CII has been able to set up with the Government of India some of the most important sector skills councils in the services area, like healthcare and others, and where we think skills is a very important aspect of really helping the Indian services sector to take that advantage that is today waiting for them. We all know about the IT sector's performance over the last many years, but there are several other sectors which we feel can be, given the right policy framework, can really contribute largely. The tourism sector, of course, is one where we think there is immense potential of both prospects in terms of the inflow, in terms of the revenue, plus also in terms of employment generation. One has also talked about the film and the entertainment industry, where we can see, just for an example, an increase of 2.7 from 2.7 million by we are looking at a figure of 2.7 million by 2018 and 4 million by 2022 from just about 1 million, which was a couple of years back. But more importantly, every direct employment creating around four indirect employment in terms of in some of these sectors, especially tourism, film and entertainment, healthcare sector. So there is a study which CII is now doing into each of these sectors as to how we can, where we are looking at the skills gap in each of these sectors, along with the state governments, where in each of the states, what are the gaps in skills in each of the services sector, in each of the sectors. So the metrics is between the states and the different sectors within the services. And also we are looking at what are the policy changes, both at the state level and the central level, which we would really like to focus on in terms of making us realize the huge scope that we all of us believe. Over the next couple of days, today and tomorrow, we would be actually discussing some of these areas into much greater detail in several panels and sessions that you would have seen in the program structure. And we do hope that the deliberations would be very fruitful. With that, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to once again welcome each one of you to this very important conclave, and thank you very much for participating. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Banerjee, for your opening remarks. I'd now like to invite Mr. Malvinder Mohan Singh, who is the chairman of the Services Council, CII. He's a young and dynamic business leader who's already made his mark on the global landscape. The driving objectives have been business for profit and business for public good. He has been key in shaping the contours of the healthcare and investment in services industry in India by walking and working through its evolution. Ladies and gentlemen, the remarks by the chairperson of the Services Council, Sri Malvinder Mohan Singh.
Honorable Minister Sri Arun Jaitley Ji, Minister of Finance, Corporate Affairs and Information and Broadcasting. Honorable Minister Nirmala Sitharaman Ji, Minister of Commerce and Industry. Shri Rajiv Kher Ji, Commerce Secretary, Government of India. Mr. Ajay Shriram, President, CII. Mr. Adil Zainubhai, Chairman, Quality Council of India. Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, Director General, CII. Members of the government, Secretary, Joint Secretaries, members of the Commerce and Industry Ministry, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I join Mr. Banerjee in extending a very, very warm welcome to our Minister, Shri Arun Jaitley Ji, and Minister Nirmala Sitharaman Ji. I want to thank you very much, ma'am, for your team, who've been extremely supportive and helpful in putting the second Service Council conclave together. This is something that we'd started last year, clearly keeping in mind the huge opportunity and the potential that we have in the services sector in India, and also keeping in mind the critical role that the service sector plays in the growth rate for us in the economy. So while the services sector today is close to 60% of our economy, clearly the growth that we've seen over the last 15 years has substantially been driven by the services sector. As we move forward and as we look forward to a strong growth rate with Prime Minister Modi at the helm of affairs of the government, and very, very, very clearly seeing a 10-year roadmap in terms of where the government and the Prime Minister would like to take India, we at CII certainly believe that the services sector will continue to play a critical role in the growth of the Indian economy. So if we have to get to a 10% growth rate, clearly the services sector, which has been growing at around 9% over the last many years, will be expected to grow in double digits. And therefore, there lies a substantial opportunity for us to do more than what we've been doing over the last many years. The IT sector, as we all know, over the last 20 years has really been the forefront and the face of India at a global level, the face of the service sector at a global level. But as we move and as hopefully we work towards moving from a 60% share of services in the global, in the GDP of the country, And if we were to move towards the 65%, the kind of opportunity that lies there for the services sector in India is absolutely immense. So while at a global level, if you look at the services sector across every economy, we may be ranked close to number 10, but the opportunity for us to move that upwards really puts forward that opportunity that India has, and therefore the opportunity for exporting of services that come upfront in terms of what we're all working towards over the next 2 days to debate and discuss. The various sectors that clearly have this opportunity, like was mentioned by Mr. Banerjee as well, is in terms of tourism, professional services, healthcare, financial services, retail, wholesale trade. So there are a series of sectors where we believe India is well positioned to take advantage of the growth rates. I'll just give you a quick example in terms of healthcare. In Singapore, for example, every dollar that gets spent on healthcare, there is an incremental $8 that gets spent within the economy. So if we are able to bring even $1 of healthcare in India, there will be a multifold increase in the spending that happens in the Indian economy. We certainly believe that India has the opportunity to be the destination of the services sector globally if small countries like Dubai and Singapore can do that. And as the world looks at Asia in terms of investment, in terms of growth, certainly India is extremely well positioned to capitalize on that opportunity. But if we are to work towards capitalizing on this opportunity, there is certainly a lot of things that we in India need to be working upon. What we clearly need is a world-class infrastructure that will enable people to be connected, that will enable people from a connectivity perspective, a road network perspective, ports, power, a whole host of infrastructure-related aspects which we as a nation need to put on a higher priority in order to provide the services sector to be able to grow and flourish. We also need a very strong IT backbone, not only to conduct business, but also from being able to have a strong governance mechanism and to be able to use the IT network and the digital backbone in the country to be able to access and connect people across the country, even in the smallest towns and villages that we have. I would also request the ministers here to look at creating a very strong enabling regulatory environment. And by that, I really mean about making sure that India is looked at as one of the preferred countries from an investor's perspective in terms of ease of doing business, not only for people in the domestic market, but also for foreign investment. I think it's very important if we have to create and leverage the opportunity in the services sector, we must be able to create an investor-friendly environment, have India as a country where people believe doing business is easy, it's simple, where policies are consistent, they are long-term oriented, and they are transparent in terms of the governance mechanism and the framework in which we will be operating in. I think while these are some very large tasks, but if we are able to work towards some of these areas, I'm quite certain this will go a long way in bringing in FDI, in bringing in sticky investments and capital into India, and for us to be able to build upon the dream and the opportunity that we all have to see India continue to prosper and grow. I certainly believe the time is now for us to make this big leap. While there will be incremental changes across different subsectors in the service sector that will keep happening from time to time, but I would certainly request the ministers here to work with us to look at a multi-stakeholder approach between the government, between business, between the various industry associations in order to create a long-term vision for the services sector and then to chart out the roadmap that will eventually take us in that direction. Thank you very much.
Mr. Manmohan Mohan Singh, thank you very much. I'd now like to invite Mr. Ajay Sriram to give his observations. He's, of course, President CII. He's the chairperson of the governing board of the Sriram College of Commerce. He's also a patron of the SOS Children's Villages and a trustee of Save the Children India. He has considerable experience in the agro-rural sectors and, of course, value-added business sectors. So I hand over to the President, CII.
Honorable Minister Shri Arun Jaitley Ji, Honorable Minister of State Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman, Mr. Rajiv Kher, Mr. Adil Zainul Bhai, Mr. Malvinder Mohan Singh, Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, distinguished delegates, friends, ladies and gentlemen. Let me add my own welcome to everyone here and especially to our guests who've come this morning. I am particularly honored to welcome Shri Arun Jaitley Ji, whose participation at this platform, despite his busy schedule, accentuates the high importance placed on services exports by the government. Sir, your presence encourages and supports us, and we look forward to your guidance, both as Minister of Finance and new Minister of Information and Broadcasting. I also have the great privilege to welcome Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman, who has actively propounded the cause of Indian engagement in the global economy since assuming charge. Thank you, ma'am, for giving a valuable time to this initiative. I'd like to also warmly welcome Mr. Rajiv Kher to taking out time and being with us this morning. Industry feels assured that under the able guidance of the new government, our economic reforms agenda would be implemented in a sustainable manner, which would help India charting an upward trend on the growth path. India has made tremendous strides in the services exports over the last two decades, and especially since the turn of the century. It is hard to believe that in 1999-2000, India's service exports stood at just $15.7 billion. The figure in 2013-14 is $151 billion, and in the intervening years, this has multiplied 10 times, a great achievement for any country indeed. In fact, India's services exports experienced the fastest growth rate in the world, at over 20% CAGR since 2001. Services exports now constitute close to a third of India's aggregate exports, and the share of India in global services exports has multiplied three times since 2000, from 1.1% to 3.3%. Export of IT and ITES has opened a new chapter in the services exports of the country. This has also strengthened our connect with people, technology, and nations. From New Delhi to New York and Boston to Bengaluru, we have an IT connect that brought people and technology together. Our challenge is to spread that connect in other segments in services. India should emerge as the most preferred destination for those who are seeking quality medical treatment, education, leisure travel, sourcing price competitive content, entertainment packages, legal services, medical transcriptions, tuitions in subjects like mathematics, physics, chemistry, and the like. After the PM's call at the United Nations to declare one day as the International Yoga Day, I see no reason why we cannot export services like yoga and also music, dance, and other cultural activities in a well-organized and structured manner. We can unbound these potentialities to surge ahead in our services exports. That requires mapping of our potentialities and identifying niche markets where these services are needed. Also, we have to embark on spread of technology, not only among the educated and younger age group, but also among the people who are living in far-flung areas. Happily, we are in the midst of a technology revolution. A weaver in Kanchipuram or Banaras can export his or her creative designs to an overseas buyer digitally through his or her PC. Or a folk artist in Bengal can sell a digitally recorded dance recital to an art fan in Paris. Or a science teacher in suburban Allahabad can teach students in the US through Skype or any other digital mode. Every capability and experience can be monetized, be it an Ayurvedic doctor, a folk artist, or a researcher. The recent Make in India campaign, launched by the Honorable Prime Minister of India, is the most visionary step taken by the government. The fillip to manufacturing will also galvanize the services sector and would make it easier for India to attract FDI inflows, which in turn would help integrate Indian products in the global supply chain. This would deepen India's strategic footprint in the world. Let me outline some of the current pressure points which are applicable to services as a whole. The first challenge is to build the Indian talent pool and create a skilled workforce that is aligned to global standards for service providers. There are many gaps in our skill development and education infrastructure to provide the necessary globally accepted qualifications for customer satisfaction for total delivery. In the medical sector alone, India faces a shortage of 1.4 million doctors and 2.8 million nurses for its own patients as well as for healthcare exports. Despite an expected medical travel inflow of over 3 million foreign patients, we fall behind countries such as Thailand and Singapore. In other professional services too, such as accounting and management, there are significant skill issues. The second challenge is to build the requisite infrastructure for services exports in the country. We need to have a wide array of film cities, education hubs, R&D centers of excellence, hospitals, and other facilities that will be able to provide world-class services in world-class environments at competitive costs. Third, there is a need to open avenues for Indian participation in the global economy through measures such as mutual recognition agreements, services trade agreements, faster visa clearances, and better air connectivity. India has done well to offer visa on arrival facility to certain countries for tourism purposes. Facilitative and quick visa approvals can be extended to other purposes such as attending conferences, higher education, and healthcare. We must also take care to ensure facilitative visas and totalization agreements for services provided overseas. India would also need to place strong emphasis on services trade agreements, which have fallen behind the trade and goods agreements that India has instituted in several countries. Such agreements should ensure a greater participation of the Indian services sector in other economies in order to build the services export profile. Awareness about WTO rules, regulations, compliance metrics, etc., is critical to deepen the services exports. Exporters need access to real-time information of quality standards, entry requirements, and generic policy structure in host countries. We should introduce measures to offset disadvantages faced by Indian service providers due to unilateral or preferential liberalization and ensure their compatibility with WTO provisions. A key endeavor would be to attract more foreign capital into the services sector in a well-diversified manner, which would require addressing roadblocks in certain sectors, which would be discussed today and tomorrow. I'm confident that once these issues are addressed, services exports from India will grow rapidly. This services export conclave is a great effort of the Government of India in partnership with industry to enhance services exports, and CII is delighted to spearhead this process along with the Government of India. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We'd now like to invite Mr. Adil Zainul Bhai, the Chairman of the Quality Council of India, to say a few words, and I'm sure he'll have some path-breaking ideas on re-imaging services.
Honorable Minister Shri Arun Jaitley ji, Honorable Minister Shrimati Nirmala Sitharaman ji, Mr. Malvinder Singh, Mr. Ajay Sriram, Mr. Rajiv Kher, Mr. Chandrajit Banerjee, and friends. I was asked to say a few words at this conclave, but actually I only wanted to say one word and then leave the rest of the time to our honorable ministers whom we all want to hear about. And my one word in terms of making the service sector successful and to increase our exports is really quality. But since you all are here and you want to hear a few more words, I'll make it three words. Quality, quality, quality. If you want to hear a few more words, I can repeat it a few more times. The reason I raise this is if you look at
the success of our exports in any sector that we have,
it isn't that the government imposes a standard of quality. It is that the people who are developing those services themselves decided that they have to have a very high standard of quality and a very high international standard that they would meet, such that our exports and our services would be among the best in the world. You did not wait for the government to mandate a minimum level of quality. You came up with your own
of the world's best quality standards and adhered to it. Our IT services today are among the world's best. We've got certification programs that have come up through the industry that has helped them improve their standards, and everyone recognizes the quality of that. And I can go on and on. There are no standards that the government or anyone externally has imposed on the quality of entertainment. Right? The entertainment industry itself comes up with what are their standards for entertainment, for creating quality entertainment. And so the reason I stress quality is if we could, in fact, ask each one, not ask the government for new policies, but if we could ask each of the industries that participate to set a global benchmark in terms of their quality, then not only will it improve the quality of services for 125 crore people in India who partake of those services, but also of the large number of people around the world and the large number of companies that are going to take our services. Remember, whatever we export is substantially less than the services that we provide at home. 56% or 57%, I think you said, were 58% of the GDP of India is services. And those are services that are consumed by 125 crore citizens of the country. And as the Prime Minister said, and as all of us would hope, we would like to improve the quality of our lives for 125 crore people. In that context, I think we as industry and we as individual companies ought to think about how do we fundamentally improve the quality of all services in India. Today we are talking about some of the export services, which are of course critical, but why don't we talk about all services in India, the services that are provided to the citizen. For example, government services. For example, services when we deal with local government, state government, central government. Services when we deal with the healthcare sector. Services when we deal with the education sector. For example, in hospitals today, the best hospitals are going for international accreditation. I think, Belinda, York, and other teams who are now going for not taking minimum standards, they're taking maximum standards of the best standards in the world and saying, we will adhere to those and help us get there. What if we took many of our services? That's not the case, by the way, for primary healthcare centers. It's not the case for clinics. It's not the case for services that the individuals in India get all the time. But what if we can aspire to creating a standard that all services get to, that are really globally benchmarked, adjusted for India, but that in fact we can be proud of them and our citizens can partake of them and say this is great. Okay. If we can do that, then I think the quality of exports will also go up and the exports will grow naturally. So rather than confuse and complicate and give you any more statistics, I just want to get back to my original premise, which is to fundamentally improve exports and services and to improve exports, we ought to think about improving the quality in everything we do, improving the quality in every aspect of services in India, which is 58% of the GDP, including government services, education services, healthcare services. I would say as a country, there's about 5% of our industry that has reached world-class standards in services, and that's fantastic, and we can see the results of that across the world. Our goal ought to be, why don't we make that 100% of our industries achieving the best standards in the world? I'm reminded that about a month and a half ago, there was a large conclave on quality in China where the premier spoke to them and basically said that whatever we have achieved in manufacturing in China, we need a 10 to 20 year target to improve our quality so that it's better than Japan and Germany. And if they're doing that, in services, why don't we say, as the leader in services and some of the services and as one of the largest exporters of services, that we should get to the point where our services are in fact the benchmark around which the rest of the world tries to catch up. So I'd like to end my few comments once again to come back to the one word that I started with, which is quality. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Zainulbhai. I'd now like to request the Commerce Secretary, Sri Rajiv Kherji, to please deliver the theme address.
Honorable Finance Minister, Honorable Commerce and Industry Minister, distinguished gentlemen on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, I am conscious of the fact that honorable ministers have pressures on their time, and therefore I will not like to take too long in setting the stage for this two-day conclave. You have heard previous speakers. Those of you who have followed after the last year's initial conclave would be aware that there is a tremendous focus that we have tried to build up around the subject of trade in services. It has been the perception in the Department of Commerce, which is validated by the facts, that services have played a very crucial role in India's foreign trade profile, but we have not given adequate focus to the manner in which we can play a much more significant role on the global platform in order to build our presence in a much more significant manner. Today, we have about 3.3% share in the global services exports. EU has 42%, China has more than 4%. India is still considered as a mine for services delivery, and yet we don't even have 3.5% of the share. So clearly there is a huge challenge ahead. This conclave was basically initiated last year for four objectives. The first objective was to sensitize all communities of stakeholders that there is something called trade in services, whether you look at domestic or you look at international. And earlier, Mr. Zainulbhai mentioned about the domestic quality dimension of services. And obviously, if you don't have domestic quality, then you cannot think of competing in the international market. So the first thing is sensitizing ourselves about the scope and potential of services exports. The second thing is, after having sensitized ourselves, to look at what is that product and market mix for services. Now, last year, we went into this kind of iterative exercise. We identified about 7 or 8 areas where we believe we are quite good and we can reach international standards in a relatively shorter effort. And we have scheduled sessions these 2 days on those identified sectors. And clearly, those are the sectors which are the winning sectors to begin with. And therefore, we need to focus on those sectors. And in the context of the strength and opportunities in those sectors, need to identify markets where we would like to move in and we would like to strengthen ourselves. Away from today's one pony approach of information technology-based services. Information technology-based services can remain the spine of India's services which are offered because we have unique advantage there, but we can build up a huge profile around that particular service area to build up a huge basket of services to offer. The third area this automatically leads to is what kind of domestic reforms that are required to make us competitive in the international market. For too long, we have focused on Mode 4, which is services delivered by movement of natural persons. In a demography of this kind, it will be necessary for us to continue to have adherence to Mode 4. But clearly, there is a strong case for us to look at Mode 2 and Mode 3. Mode 2 is an area where services are delivered to the service receiver at home in the service provider's country. Clearly, tourism and healthcare are huge potential, and we need to look at them. But then there is a huge amount of domestic reform which is required. Similarly, professional services. Now, there are the reforms which are required range from very small rule amendments to significant legal changes. If you look at the services relating to accountancy, auditing, legal services, R&D services, and so on. And there is a huge potential ahead there. We need to work on a roadmap to do that, to open our professional services. And lastly, we need to look at international rules making. In 2005, we gave our revised offers in the WTO. Thereafter, unfortunately, WTO has also been in some kind of a limbo. But having said that, in the meanwhile, there is a plurilateral trade in services agreement which is being negotiated. For reasons which are known to many of you, we have not been able to participate in that process. But that is a good enough challenge for us to prepare ourselves to be able to participate in a much broader exercise in the WTO itself and create an environment in the WTO for other developing countries to come and participate in a much more advanced rulemaking exercise. So there are these four areas which we believe this conclave will give an opportunity to different sectoral experts to allude to and to bring up an agenda for the next few years. Our idea is that this conclave mechanism will operate for the next 5 years. The whole idea is to identify services, create reforms agenda, and the Department of Commerce will operate as an anchor to facilitate this reforms agenda, though most of the reforms will not actually take place within the Department of Commerce, but they will be all in other departments. But nonetheless, we recognize the importance, and therefore we will anchor that. So this is the broad canvas on which this conclave has been organized. We believe that you will participate, keeping in mind that this is not a one-off event. And last year, we gave ourselves an agenda, and we have now worked on that agenda, and you will know in the sessions what has been done. Similarly, this conclave, this meeting, should also give out an agenda to build upon the last year's agenda, so that at the end of 5 years, we have a target. We have a target to achieve, both in terms of exports of services and domestic reforms, which are utmost important for achieving those targets. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. I'd now like to request the Honorable Minister for Commerce and Industry, Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman ji, to please deliver the special address.
Good morning, everybody. Honorable Finance Minister and the dignitaries on the dais, participants on this for the service conclave, which is a two-day event. I'm very grateful that the Finance Minister has agreed to inaugurate this session, and I'm aware that all of us are very keen to hear from him his ideas on how our government is committed to encourage and facilitate the service sector, because it has immense potential, immense untapped potential too, particularly in sectors where, other than the IT and IT-enabled sector, where certainly contribution to the GDP has been very high, but there are other industries, such as all the other speakers have said, whether it's film, entertainment, hospitality, wellness, a whole lot of other things, you know, professional services and so on, all of which over the decades have on their own, with probably minimum assistance from the government, have shown excellence. The anxiety which Adilji expressed in establishing quality, they have striven over the decades and established such quality which have given them excellence in international recognition. Most of them are accredited all over the world. So, at this stage where it is already contributing substantially to the GDP, and we also recognize untapped potential existing within that sector, it is for us from the government now to see as to how we can facilitate. The 2 days conclave, I hope, will give us a good lot of input for us to know where this government can come in without being a hindrance, and further realize the potential. without taking much more time, because all of us are very keen to know our FM's mind on this matter, I would only say again, I'm very grateful that the Finance Minister chose to come and inaugurate this event, and we look forward from the Commerce Ministry for your inputs, which will come out after 2 days' deliberation. Thank you for all your participation. We certainly look forward for a meaningful interaction. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Honourable Minister. I'd now like to request the Honourable Minister of Finance and Information and Broadcasting and Corporate Affairs to please deliver the inaugural address. Sri Arun Jaitley Ji.
My colleague in the government, Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman, secretaries, industry leaders, ladies and gentlemen. I have almost a vested interest in the service sector exports doing well for more than one reason. It substantially covers up for the deficit in the merchandise sector. And therefore, it helps me in keeping the government accounts partly in a little more presentable shape. Secondly, the very nature of Indian economy is such that the share of agriculture and manufacturing sector over the years has partly shrunk. And one of the great challenges is that you have almost 15-16% of our national GDP and 60% of the people in agriculture dependent on it. You have therefore to create jobs outside the agricultural sector, where people start migrating from the agricultural sector, lessen the level of underemployment in that sector, and move on to manufacturing and services. The real job creation is in the manufacturing sector. And that's why one of our national challenges is that this 15% odd share of manufacturing today has to be increased to 25%. But that's an uphill task. And therefore, that leaves us essentially with the services sector, whose growth is a low-hanging fruit in India. The Commerce Secretary mentioned that the international trade dialogue is in some forms of a limbo. And I partly suspect one of the reasons for it. I am going into a subject which will have a direct bearing on the purpose of this convention. The WTO was intended to be an organization which could lay down the rules for a rule-based trade. It's substantially fulfilling that purpose, and that's necessary. It was also intended to be an area which would lay down such rules of trade where some countries themselves could dominate. But then somewhere down the line, this whole definition of globalization substantially changed. And the market forces itself pushed a new definition. And that definition was born out of the fact that the choice eventually rests with the consumers. And consumers globally are going to buy products or hire services which they find are cheaper or of good quality. There is no patriotism or jingoism in the matter of trade. I can't compel my consumers in India that please buy a costlier product or a qualitatively a low product merely because there is some element of patriotism attached to it. Very few will listen to me. As a result of which, in your manufactured products, the dialogue is at a standstill because people want to buy most manufactured products which are manufactured in low-cost economies. And the developed world had outpriced itself. And therefore, when we say the Make in campaign, an essential ingredient, Make in India campaign, the essential ingredient has to be what is made in India must also be, in terms of prices, competitive. And we still find in the merchandise products our cost of capital, our somewhat our labor regime, our infrastructure, the improvements which are required in our trade facilitation, they still have to assist us in order to bring down the prices of our manufactured products. And as a part of the Make in India campaign, these are special areas we'll always have to address, and address very soon. We are in the process of doing so. Now, contradistinct this with the services sector. I have a lurking suspicion that we've got services sector to occupy about 60% of the GDP space, because this is one sector where the governmental interferences are the least. Restrictions at entry point are very little. Controls are very little. And therefore you unleash energies and allow people to grow. The second aspect is that in terms of services, we have proved to be competent service providers globally. Now, it is here that we have to seize the initiative and just as some countries have become the global workshops in manufacturing, and we are endeavoring to reach that target, we have to become globally service providers in some of the areas. Our success in IT and IT-enabled services is well known. Why should somebody on the same principle of cheaper services? Several US presidents have tried to impose restrictive regimes on outsourced services. They feel that it costs jobs in the US. But which indirectly translated in simple languages means that you are compelling the US consumer to buy costlier services from within their own country when the same service is available almost in same real time at a minuscule fraction of that cost outside. And these moves have substantially not succeeded. Now, how do we expand from there? Not merely because Malvinder is here, but his is one area where we are beginning to create our impact. We are almost at the starting point. We are providing global healthcare, global quality healthcare in a very large number of our hospitals and medical institutions at a fraction of the international cost. Now, if Indian doctors withdrew from the national health services in some of the developed countries, those services would collapse. So it's the same set of doctors which manage these services internationally. They provide the same services in India at far more efficient costs. And therefore, the global traffic which has begun to swing India's way has now to crowd that highway. And therefore, healthcare is an easy target where we can endeavor to become an important center. R&D. We have scientists, we have researchers in this country, because with such a large population, the human resource is very large, and the trained human minds are much larger in number. And therefore, R&D centers in India will cost you a fraction of what they cost internationally. So why should any pharmaceutical company or any other company not be tempted to set up those centers in India? Our tourism industry, I've said this earlier and I'm repeating it, in a country which has a huge tourist attraction, costly tourism will not help us. Sluggish services will not help us. So our target really is to provide hotels, to provide domestic travel facilities, to provide cleaner trains, to provide efficient domestic airlines, direct connectivity of flights, easier visa facilities, visa on arrivals, e-visas. All these facilities, if we provide them cheaper, the essence of growth is going to be in volumes. And it's volumes, as Thailand has done, which can actually put this sector right on top. Our entertainment. We control 1/6 of the global eyeballs. And therefore, we have a large expatriate population internationally. And interest in our entertainment has now gone beyond merely people, persons of Indian origin. It's extending to others. There's no reason why the global potential of our industry should not expand. Our educational hubs. It may still be difficult for us to attract too many from the developed countries. But can't we stop this flow of people wanting to go out and spend a lot of foreign? So how much do universities in England, Australia, United States earn from Indian students? Why can't we at least be a regional hub with quality institutions of that kind? And I think these are areas where we need to be aggressive. If we are on the defensive in services, even a large number of professional services. People are now devising means of defying and bypassing those bans. So where direct offices are not allowed, indirect hubs are coming, offices are coming up. And therefore these artificial defensive mechanisms itself won't prevent our potential. Our potential is right there in front of us. And I think there's a huge space to grow. I do hope in the course of the next 2 days in this services conclave being organized by the Department of Commerce and the CII, we are able to reflect on some of those issues and reflect on areas where we have a potential to grow so that our services sector exports can realize this low-hanging fruit, which by even global standards is very, very achievable as far as India is concerned. I wish your conclave a great success. Thank you.
Thank you, Honorable Minister. With that, we come to an end of the inaugural session. I'd like to thank Honorable Minister Sri Arun Jaitley, Honorable Minister Sri Nirmala Sitharamanji, of course, Mr. Kher, Mr. Sriram, Mr. Malvinder Mohan Singh, Mr. Adil, General Bhai, and of course, Mr. Sriram. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank all the members who have attended this session. Thank you for your presence, and we really look forward to the interactions over the next couple of days. For now, we'll wait for a tea coffee break. We'll reassemble in about 15 minutes from now. Thank you.
छोड़ दिया।
गुरु मैं गुरु को पकड़ा
चक्कर ही बोल दिया था भाई, चक्कर ही बोल दिया था, इतनी लंबी कोई नहीं बोल रहा है।